છે મનાઈ દઈશ. ખીચડી બન જાય તો બસ હોય કે શેડ્યુલ નહીં કે કોઈ એનરોલ નહીં કરાવી તો. હાય, ગુડ મોર્નિંગ એવરીવન. આઈ એમ ડોક્ટર બુદ્ધદેવ ચૌધરી.
નહીં, ઇસકો નહીં આવે સર.
તો ફેર
ઇસકો ફોન પે આવેગા
સર. ફોન મેં કરાવ, ફોન મેં જોઈન કરાવ
સર. હું આપકો લિંક ભેજના પડેગા સર.
લિંક દીજિએ. 9868 0 9868 0 4 3 0 6 7 6 7.
સર ઉસી ચલ જતા સબ
ક્યુ નહીં ચલા ક્યાં ચલા ક્યાં નહીં. આપણે રખ દીજે, કોણ જોઈન કરો જીત જાયગા.
तो चालू कर सकते हैं। 23 लोग ऐसे करिए, 23 लोग चालू कर
सकते हैं। मुझे तो कंट्रैक्ट नहीं कर पाऊँगा ना, कंट्रैक्ट कैसे करूँगा, वो खुल ही नहीं रहा है।
स्टूडेंट है इंजीनियरिंग का स्टूडेंट है।
सॉरी गाइस, आई कांट सी यू, माय इट्स नॉट कनेक्टिंग ऑन माय फोन, आई कांट सी यू एनीवन ऑफ यू। एनीवे आई डोंट नो हाउ टू इंटरैक्ट बिकॉज इट्स नॉट कनेक्टिंग। आई विल जस्ट गो ऑन विद द लेक्चर्स। आपके उसमें फोटो आ रहा है क्या? तो इंटरैक्ट कैसे करेंगे, उसके थ्रू कराऊँ?
नहीं, इससे होगा डायरेक्ट,
इससे होगा। चलिए ओके फाइन। सो वी विल टॉक अबाउट ऑस्टियोमायलाइटिस। आई एम श्योर बाय नाउ यू नो व्हाट ऑस्टियोमायलाइटिस इज। ऑस्टियोमायलाइटिस इज इन्फेक्शन इन्वॉल्विंग बोन्स, कैन बी अक्यूट एंड क्रॉनिक। सी दीज आर द वेरियस हेडिंग्स। I'm going to briefly touch every heading and we will proceed. So, history and introduction. Right? It dates back to, the early 19th century when Hippocrates first recognized it. Right? And then Nilaton in 1841 coined the term osteomyelitis. The mid early 20th century, penicillin was discovered and the antibiotics was introduced in the management of osteomyelitis. Now, as I said, ostea is bone, myelos marrow and inflammation. So it's the inflammation of the marrow and the bone. It's a clinical state of infection of the bone and marrow by microorganisms. It is seen more often in males than females and more so in immunocompromised patients. Trauma is also a cause of the infection osteomyelitis. Close fracture it is less than 2%, but in the open fractures, grade 1, 2, 3 open fractures, it is about 10 to 25%. So it is the infective process involving the various components of bone, characterized by progressive inflammation, destruction of bone, necrosis and new bone formation. The new bone formation, it is part of the osteomyelitis. Now it is acute or chronic. Introduction is, it is about 20% is by hematogenous distribution and 80% is direct inoculation, post-traumatic, post-operative, right? And 10 to 20% acute osteomyelitis becomes chronic. Almost 1/5 of acute osteomyelitis, it continues to become chronic osteomyelitis. Hematogenesis is endogenous, contiguous is exogenous, and when it's chronic, it becomes with necrotic bone. There are various stages of classification. Twister stages of osteomyelitis classification is like the boil in the bone. Signs and symptoms become very severe and there is subperiosteal abscess. Now there are four types as described by Cerny and Madden. Type 1 is medullary, Type 2 is superficial, type 3 is localized, and type 4 is diffuse. This is an anatomic classification. The physiologic classification is like host, when its host is healthy. Type B, when the host is compromised. Type C, host is prohibited. Right? Now, have a look at the picture. This is the schematic diagram. This is the medullary. Then you have the superficial. Then you have the localized. And you have diffuse, where the bone is diffusely involved. The causes. The first one is, of course, hematogenesis, when it is microbial, right? And number two, osteomyelitis by direct inoculation, by contiguous spread, like polymicrobial. When usually it is hematogenous, it is monomicrobial. When it is by direct inoculation, like injuries or surgery or injection, then it is mostly polymicrobial. Staph aureus is the most common causative organism. Almost 2/5 of all the infections is caused by a staph aureus. So we would, this is our study. Staphylococcus induced bone infection requires extensive research with a focus on the molecular mechanism adapted by staphylococcus to cause infection. See, because till date, staphylococcus is a nuisance. It's the cause of most of the osteomyelitis. Other organisms, like in the kids, you have streptococci, E. coli, and so on. You can see the list here, right? In the immunosuppressed patient, in Pseudomonas and Nocardia. And in the prosthesis, when you have both surgery, so staph epidermidis. Pathology. In hematogenous spread, usually it is metaphysis of the lung bones in children or the vertebral bodies in adults. Right? What happens? Direct inoculation, penetrating injuries and surgical contamination is direct inoculation. And otherwise, it is from the contiguous focus. The metaphysis is commonest site of osteomyelitis because it is highly vascular, has a hairpin-like arrangement of capillaries. The blood flow is very sluggish, so the organisms can settle down there and colonize. Has relatively fewer phagocytic cells than the physis or diaphysis, allowing infection to occur more easily in this area, right? So the killing is slow, very slow here in this region. You have rapid growth of cells in this region. Affection of the epiphyseal zone is characteristic of children under the age of 2 to 3 years. With age, when the system of blood supply to the metaphysis begins to develop intensively, it's the metaphysis that predominantly becomes affected, right? From epiphysis to metaphysis. Factors influencing, systemic factors, these are the various factors: malnutrition, anemia, and underlying disease. Local factors, if you have chronic lymphedema, if the local tissue is not good, then it can get affected. Pathology in acute osteomyelitis, it is inflamed, there is pus pouring out, suppuration, there is tissue dies very fast, necrosis, new bone formation, the periosteal reaction, and eventually, if it happens, then the resolution. Inflammatory stage, the first 24 hours, it is highlighted by hallmark is vascular congestion, polymorphonuclear leukocyte infiltration, exudation, and there's raised intraosseous pressure and intense pain, intravascular thrombosis with ischemia. After 2 to 3 days, the pus formation is there. There is subperiosteal abscess via the Wolfman canals. Pus spreads along the epiphysis or to the joint. It can invade the medullary cavity or the soft tissues. Then there's a stage of necrosis, bone death by the end of the week. Because of the cut off vascular supply, there's thrombosis of the microvessels, the blood supply gets cut off and there is bone destruction. So bone destruction is sort of twofold, by either by the toxin of the organism or by ischemia. Both they lead to vascular coagulation, cut off of the vascular supply. Epiphyseal plate injury, and then there is sequestrum formation. There is a small removed by macrophage, osteophyte, large they remain. Small ones are removed, large ones they remain. Now the new bone formation, by the end of the second week there is involucrum, which is a new bone formation from deep layer of periosteum surrounding infected tissues. There is a sort of case forms around the infected tissues, a shell. If the infection persists, first discharge through sinus to skin surface, and this is the stage when we say the chronic osteomyelitis sets in. So this is a flow chart. You can see bacterial impaction, what happens next. There is bone necrosis, and then the subperiosteal abscess collection which tracks down, then detachment of periosteum, and there's extensive ischemic necrosis of the bone. If the osteomyelitis process is not recognized, beginning from 4th to 5th day of the disease, the pus spreads. Later, pus and the products of disintegration continue. Clinical picture, the toxic form follows an extremely violent course with signs of endotoxic shock. Dyspnea is found, but without any clear clinical picture of pneumonia. There is dyspnea, but the pneumonia is not clear. There is cardiovascular abnormalities. You get punctate extravasations are often seen on the skin. These are the clinical picture. The tongue is dry with a brownish coating. The abdomen is usually distended and tender in the upper part. The liver may be enlarged. So you have the septicopyemic form. The onset of the disease is also acute. Body temperature rises, signs of toxicosis increases, confused consciousness, pain in the affected limb, and the septic complications caused by the spread of the purulent foci to various organs. In the localized form, which is characterized by a predominance of local signs of purulent inflammation over the general clinical manifestations of the disease. Now the treatment. We have to, for supportive treatment is you give splint, antibiotic therapy, surgical drainage. In the supportive treatment you give analgesic, correction of dehydration, splintage, plaster slab or traction combined with preventive, which prevents joint contracture. Antibiotics. Initial antibiotics is the best guess. According to smear findings, according to incidences, age, proper antibiotics according to culture and sensitive tests. Nage principle for treatment of acute hematogenous osteomyelitis. An appropriate antibiotic will be effected before pus formation. Antibiotics will not stabilize avascular tissues or abscesses, and such areas require surgical removal. If such removal is effective, antibiotics should prevent their reformation, and therefore primary wound closure would be safe. Surgery should not further damage already ischemic bone and soft tissues. Antibiotics should be continued after surgery. Now this is the guideline, the dosage schedule of various antibiotics. Certain regimen of treatment for acute osteomyelitis and septic arthritis in children. So conclusion, it is found that there is a shortened course of intravenous and oral antibiotic therapy which is effective in the management of acute uncomplicated bone and joint sepsis in children. Prolonged intravenous therapy versus early transitional to oral antimicrobial therapy for acute osteomyelitis in children. Treatment of acute osteomyelitis with early transition to oral therapy is not associated with a higher risk of treatment failures and avoids the risk of prolonged IV therapy through central venous catheters. So, the take-home message is that in the treatment of acute osteomyelitis with early transition to oral therapy is advocated. Surgical drainage. Early treatment, no need of surgery. Later treatment, surgical drainage is needed for about in 1/3 of cases. If first found and released, no need to drill bone, but drilling one or two holes if no obvious abscesses found. Surgery for the acute osteomyelitis, when is it indicated? When there is an abscess which requires drainage. Failure to improve despite appropriate IV antibiotic therapy for 48 hours. What's the goal? To drain any abscess cavity and remove all non-viable or necrotic tissue and to decrease the pressure. Treatment. In the view of the fact that most severe forms of osteomyelitis are consequent upon intraosseous hypertension, it's an incision not no less than 10 to 15 centimeters in length, which means up to 6 inches, 4 to 6 inches, and periosteum is cut longitudinally. 2 to 3 perforating openings are made, in 3 to 5 diameter are made. The marrow cavity is irrigated with 1:5000 nitrofurazone solution and antibiotics through the perforation in the bone. The complications. Bad complications are rare. Metastatic infection, multifocal infection is sometimes seen. Suppurative arthritis in very, if you seen very young patient, when the metaphysis is intracapsular, and there is also metastatic infection in young patients. There may be pathological fracture. Then chronic osteomyelitis. Invariably, it is because of the delayed diagnosis and treatment, and in debilitated patients as seen, and compromised hosts. Osteomyelitis. See here acute osteomyelitis, the flowchart. Inadequate host response, ineffective treatment, persistent colonization of bacteria leads to ultimately chronic osteomyelitis. Right? There's a biofilm theory. There are various tracing. So necrotic tissue surface is negatively charged, so binds to adhesion molecules of the bacteria and forms a biofilm. Now the gross pathology. Look at this. There's a cavity inside. There's a dead bone which is sequestrum, and there's a, you can see outside, there's a shell which is involucrum, and the opening is the cloacae. The presence of sclerotic necrotic piece of bone, usually cortical, surrounded by inflammatory exudate and granulation tissue is sequestrum. What is the features? It's a dead piece of bone. It is pale inner smooth outer rough and surrounded by infected granulation tissue trying to eat it. So these are the types, various types. And seen in, there's the various condition, the table you see on the right hand side. Now the involucrum, which is, as I said, is the sheath of reactive, new, immature subperiosteal bone that forms around the sequestrum, effectively sealing it of the bloodstream, just like a wall of abscess. Irregular it is, often perforated by openings called cloacae, may gradually increase in density and thickness to form part or all a new diaphysis. You can see the diagram here. There's the histopathology, irregular fragments of debattler's bone surrounded by dense fibrous tissue, infiltrated by plasma cells, lymphocytes, and very few granulocytes. Diagnosis, history, bone pain, past history of trauma. There may be orthopedic surgery. Most symptoms are vague and generalized. Physical examination, inspection. Sinuses may be there with discharge. Bony spicules, when it is coming out, is pathognomonic. It is pathognomonic. Discoloration of the skin, non-healing ulcer, exposed bone implant or implant, muscle atrophy, these are the you find on inspection. On palpation, deep tenderness, irregularly thickened bone is felt. There's a discharging sinus fixed to the underlying bone. Adjacent joint stiffness is there. Lab studies, the ESR is usually elevated, reflecting chronic inflammation. The TLC is an inaccurate indicator and may even be normal. CRP, rises in chronic osteomyelitis and decreases faster than the ESR in successfully treated patients. It's a more sensitive parameter than the ESR. Now these are various studies. It will be too large. Those who are interested can take it from me directly. Other tests to monitor drug toxicity. So, serum creatinine level and liver function test, nutritional status, comorbidities, e.g. like blood glucose levels for patients with diabetes. In patients with Sierra Madre stage 1 or hematogenous osteomyelitis, positive cultures of blood or joint fluid is diagnostic. Definitive diagnosis obtained from intra-bone biopsy samples. Culture specimens should be obtained before antibiotics started. Discontinue empirical regimen for 3 days before the collection samples for cultures. Cultures from the sinus tract not reliable. These are some more studies. You see, the radiographic changes usually reflect the destructive process but lag at least 2 weeks behind the process of infection. It is seen usually after 2 weeks, the radiographic changes. The earliest changes are what? Swelling of the soft tissue, periosteal thickening or elevation. There is focal osteopenia. At least 50 to 75% of the bone matrix must be destroyed before radiographs show lytic changes. So it is that late when it is shown up in radiographs. You see here, there is a sequestrum which is denser than the surrounding bone. And there's a periosteal reaction, there's a cavity in the bone. Sinography can be performed if a sinus tract is present. X-ray made in 2 planes after injection of radiograph liquid into the sinus. It is helpful in locating focus of infection in chronic osteomyelitis. It is very valuable in surgical planning. Helpful in preoperative planning, accurately shows the extent of bone destruction. Helpful to identify areas of necrotic bone and to demonstrate the involvement of the surrounding soft tissue. Look at the pictures here. MRI has very high sensitivity and specificity. Advantages, useful for differentiating between bone and soft tissue infection. and helpful, very helpful in surgical planning. Disadvantages: a metallic implant in the region of interest may produce focal artifact, false positive in tumors and healing fractures. These are of course the disadvantages. You get the proximal lytic lesions, osteopenia, deformed left femur. Look at the pictures. There's involucrum formation, bone within bone, which is the sequestrum. The bone scan is also helpful. It is excellent in screening tool with more than 90% sensitivity. Performed in three phases with technetium 99m methylene diphosphonate. Soft tissue infection, first two phases, arterial and venous, and positive when you have soft tissue infection. True skeletal infection, all three phases are positive. False positives in repeated surgeries and hardware implant. What mimics? Ewing sarcoma mimics. Bone cyst, eosinophilic granuloma, GCT, osteoid osteoma. Look at that. So, bone biopsy plus culture insensitivity is the gold standard. Now, this is the chart, the treatment chart. What do you do? We need to correct the host factor. We need to obliterate the dead space. We have to initiate antimicrobial coverage and drainage and debridement. These are some studies. Now, non-surgical treatment. Attention should be paid to good nutrition. Smoking should be stopped. Control of specific diseases such as diabetes. These are the part of the non-surgical treatment. Antibiotic treatment mainly adjuvant to surgery. Ideally should be based on the results of bone cultures. Normally, traditionally is given up to 6 weeks. Longer courses of intravenous or oral antibiotics not recommended. Failures occur mostly as a result of emergence of resistant strains or inadequate surgical debridement. Oral antibiotic with good bone penetration as good as parenteral. So, there is a role of oral antibiotic also. So, rifampicin always in combination is given in the refractory or relapse cases. Suppressive therapy for approximately 6 months. It acts against persisters, slow growing or the biofilm bacteria. It is locally administered antibiotics also. Complementary therapies, nowadays we give hyperbaric oxygen also, which augment host immune system. It allows formation of peroxides and promotes wound healing. Electrical stimulation is also employed for non-unions with acceptable alignment. So the types are direct current, inductive coupling and the capacitive coupling. Ultrasound is also used in low intensity. The surgical treatment, look at this chart here. There is tissue debridement, removal of metal implants and foreign body, stabilization of bone, local antibiotic therapy, dead space obliteration and reconstruction of soft tissues. Timing of intervention, when to operate, is the patient's will. Salvageable limbs, if the limb is salvageable, when you see Clem's trial. So involucrum in three cortices. Sequestrum separated from parent bone, subsidence of acute phase and antibiotics to be discontinued 1 week prior. Surgical treatment. Now, the principles. All the pus must be drained out. The solution to pollution is dilution, right? So use copious wash, copious wash. There's a paprika sign. So pulsatile lavage, high volume, low pressure. Pulsatile lavage is very effective. Take bone and soft tissue for biopsy and cultures. Now decide whether to leave the implant or not. Avoid excessive periosteal stripping. Meticulous care and supervised management of the wound is needed. Very vital. The surgery is saucerization. The kind of surgery is called a saucerization. It is the evacuation. It starts from hollowing the bone and in this shape, as if in a shape of saucer, right? From the periphery, you slightly deepen at the peak of the disease and take it out from the through the normal bone. You take out the sequestrum, sequestrectomy, and curettage all the infected tissues. What is the purpose? It removes all non-viable tissues and bones. It ensures adequate drainage of pus, and it prevents abscess collection. So that is the advantage of saucerization, but limited to areas with acceptable loss of function. It cannot be done and on any bone. May or may not require bone surgery at places where the bone stabilization may not be needed. Consider radical excision in ribs, fibula, clavicle, etc. So this is, see a picture, the area is outlined, there's drill holes made rectangularly and a chisel is used to take out that. So, and the sequestra is delivered out. Then it is packing with antibiotics after cleaning. Now the dead space, which has, it's the outcome of the surgery, what to do with that? So adequate debridement leaves dead space, so which predisposes to persistence or relapse of infection, right? So appropriate management requires ensure local blood supply for healing and antibiotic therapy delivery. Preserve osseous mechanical integrity. It should not lead on to a fracture. And obliterate the space and arrest the disease. How do you obliterate the space? With the healthy soft tissue. Look at this. You do open wound, papillus cancellous graft. You can do myoplasty, put muscle inside. Or you can do local closure. You can do also free bone transfer. Dead space. Cancellous bone graft, fill it. You fill it with local muscle flap. You can fill it with vascularized flap transfer. You can fill it with vascularized bone cements, bone segments. And you can fill it with bone cements with antibiotic impregnate. There are three stages. You see, debridement plus stabilization if necessary. The debrimo as per principles. Stabilize an external with external fixator or a cast or sometimes with an intramedullary device. Pack the cavity with occlusive dressing. Inspect wound occasionally. Cancellous bone grafting, which is usually taken from eyelid crest or elsewhere, cut into small longitudinal pieces which is approximately 4 to 5 millimeter thick and 4 to 5 centimeter long. Discard cortical bone. Pack cancellous species, finger tie, and occlude all dead space. Eventually vascularized and invaded by granulation tissue. This cancellous bone graft gets vascularized. Small wounds, the spontaneous epithelialization occurs. Large defects may need flap cover. Check clinical or radiographic improvement. Remove external fixators, casts. Consider protected weight bearing. This is the after wound coverage. Limitations. Large defects, which is usually more than 4 centimeters. Inadequate local vascular supply. And this inadequate soft tissues. I skipped this study too. Now the local myocutaneous flap. What does it do? It increases the blood supply to that area. It is superior to skin flaps. It obliterates the dead space and irregularly contoured osseous cavity. It provides resistance to recurrent sepsis. Gastrocnemius is most commonly used. Even cross-leg flaps are used, but then it needs prolonged immobilization, exposes normal extremity to infection. This is the pictures of some. The indications, when do you do all this? When the adjacent soft tissues cannot cover the area. Area should anatomically permit transportation of a local muscle flap without compromising its neurovascular bundle. Means without compromising the neurovascular bundle of the flap which is to be transferred in that cavity. Debridement procedure hasn't compromised the mechanical integrity of osseous structures, and cross purulence has been eliminated. Then you have the vascularized free flap. They are pedicled flap. The wound size is assessed and the muscle size in the length of the pedicle is assessed. Nearest good recipient vessel is seen. Recipient vessels should be palpated, or maybe Doppler arteriogram can be done, and position of the patient on table. Most common is lat dorsi, gracilis, TFL and omentum. Omentum is flexible, covers large irregular defects and has a long pedicle. Local antibiotic delivery system. Besides all this what we have talked about, they may be used to sterilize and temporarily maintain a dead space. Antibiotics that can be used are usually gentamicin, tobramycin, penicillin, cephalosporins, amikacin and vancomycin. These are impregnated, mixed with the bone cement. Beads are made out of these and they are placed in the cavity, and they cause slow release of the antibiotic to the surrounding. The antibiotic concentration remains for almost a month after implantation. So the delivery systems can be what? Via non-biodegradable antibiotic system, or as I said, by biodegradable antibiotic. See, the biodegradable antibiotic delivery systems are mostly proteins like collagen, gelatin, thrombin, bone graft materials and substitutes, calcium sulfate, calcium phosphate, synthetic polymers like polylactide, they all are impregnated with the antibiotic and placed in the wound where you, the saucerized wound, to close the cavity, to make the cavity sterile, infection free, for so that antibiotic can be delivered continuously, slowly. Here the biphasic injectable bone graft substitute. It is synthetic, it is osteoconductive, component is hydroxyapatite is 40% and reabsorbable continent calcium sulfate is 60%. Right? So 60% is reabsorbed and the 40% of the hydroxyapatite component acts as a scaffold where bone grows. So it is osteoconductive. Used as bone material for clinical applications due to their osteoconductivity. See, like the cavity, when you do place it, it kind of causes conduction of bone formation, osteogenesis, induction, and new bone forms there, which provides, it acts as a matrix so that new bone can form there and add to the stability. Now it is, another good part of it is injectable, it is injectability, making it possible to utilize in minimally invasive surgery techniques, like when there is a hole inside with a small hole outside in the periphery, this can be injected inside, and adequate strength and slow resorption. So in the meanwhile, till new osteoconduction is occurs, when the infection is controlled, till then it adds, it provides good strength and slowly, very slowly it resolves. When bone forming cells are in direct contact with cerament, the hydroxyapatite particles get incorporated into the newly formed bone. After treatment with cerament, complete bone formation demonstrated within 6 to 12 months, right? Advantages: void filled with bone mineral, no invasion by fibrous tissue, hardens in situ and augments the bone, acts as a scaffold for the ingrowth of bone. Look at that. Then we have non-biodegradable antibiotic system, PMMMBs, commercially available. They are pre-packaged forms. They need to be removed within 4 weeks to prevent colonization. Antibiotic bead pouch technique. You also get antibiotic impregnated nail, you can see in the picture. Now the bead pouch technique. See, the pouch is made in the cavity and the pouch of the bead is placed in a string. The role of vacuum assisted closure, VAC. Treating chronic and difficult to heal wounds. VAC is very important, very handy nowadays. These are used very often because they are very handy in treating chronic and difficult to heal wounds. There is controlled negative pressure. It accelerates wound healing, and there's a cyclical pressure. What are the components of this? There's a foam which fills the cavity. There's an occlusive dressing, adherent dressing. Then there's a drain and tube from that foam in the, which is placed in the cavity, and there's a microprocessor controlled vacuum unit, and there are canisters to contain the sucked out fluid or content from inside the cavity. This is how this is being demonstrated, this is how it is done. This is the schematic diagram, how it does. There is a cavity, there is a foam placed inside, it stimulates granulation tissue, decreases bacterial loading, right, and it enhances blood flow. So eventually, and the exudate is continuously sucked out. So eventually the floor becomes, the cavity becomes shallower with time. The floor gets elevated and the wound closes. There is a role of closed suction drains also. There is a continent when you need to suck it out completely. Then you have the elixir of external fixation. It's a very useful aid for the orthopedic surgeons, used for reconstruction of segmental defects and difficult infected non-union. Based on the technique of distraction osteogenesis, used for difficult cases of osteomyelitis when stabilization and bone lengthening are necessary. May also be used to compress non-union and to correct malunions. There's a musculate technique in which wound debridement is done, then cement spacer is placed and bone stabilizer is done in step 1. Next step, the spacer is removed, bone grafting is done. Now, the induced biomembrane, it prevents graft resorption, improves vascularity and corticalization, and secrete growth factors. This is the study of the musculate technique. This is one demonstration. Few more. Six months later, there's good consolidation, healed. These are some studies. This is a flow chart come from the studies. Now we come to the complications. You may have acute exacerbations, growth abnormalities, deformities, you may have pathological fracture. You can see these pictures, they can tell you the story. There is a shortening, there is a deformity, there is a fracture. These joint stiffness can get complicated, amyloidosis, some can turn malignant. Brody's abscess, it is another abscess which is, you know, it is usually a chronic bone abscess containing pus or jelly-like granulation tissue surrounded by a zone of sclerosis. Look at the picture, this is Brody's abscess. Usually seen in the metaphyseal region, age 11 to 20 years, upper part of the tibia or lower part of the femur. It causes deep boring pain, worse at night, relieved by rest. It is circular or oval, lucency surrounded by zone of sclerosis. Treatment is conservative rest and antibiotic. If it doesn't respond, then surgically it is evacuated and curettage. These are some chronic recurrent multifocal osteomyelitis, rare, seen in children and adolescents. Multifocal, recurrent lesions, metaphysis of long bones, prolonged symptoms, more than 6 months, associated with other inflammatory symptoms, there is no abscess, sequestrum, fistula, sinus, but then good prognosis, no role of antibiotics. They take care of them. This is CRMO. The take home message. chronic osteomyelitis remains a persistent and difficult to treat problem in orthopedics. Post-operative and post-traumatic osteomyelitis is on the rise. Diagnosis based on examination, imaging and lab findings, which helps in isolation of the organism, and it's a must. Antibiotics have adjuvant role to surgery. They need to be combined. Elaborate surgical plan to address, which is what is that? Adequate debridement, dead space management, wound healing, closure and limb reconstruction. Needs commitment. Treatment of osteomyelitis needs commitment, caution and optimism from the surgeon and the patient. Thank you so much for your patient listening. Any of you who wants further detail or any elaboration on any part of this topic, our discussion, though it was one way, it was a monologue, we could not see each other's face directly and stop and discuss, but then whenever anyone interested may approach me and we can discuss about those points or areas more elaborately. Thank you so much. Have a great day ahead.